Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 6702 in the name of Gillian Martin on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee on inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. I would invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Gillian Martin to speak to and to move the motion on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to 9 minutes, please, Ms Martin.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the motion in my name as the Convener of the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee. I'm pleased to open today's debate on the Committee's inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. And I want to thank everyone who engaged with the inquiry, whether it was through the call for views, the public survey, or informal evidence sessions, and being able to engage with so many different people in so many different ways, as we always strive to do in the Health Committee, has been invaluable in helping us to reach our final recommendations. The primary care services are the front door of the NHS, and when a person seeks healthcare, their first point of contact has traditionally been with a general practitioner. But our inquiry, however, focused on the other routes to accessing healthcare in the community, which we, for the purposes of our inquiry and a report, termed alternative pathways. These various pathways can include seeing a different and often specialist health practitioner located in the GP practice or in the local community, for example, a physiotherapist, urgent care practitioner, or a nurse. And a patient's route to treatment may be through social prescribing, which aims to improve health and well-being through activities such as talking therapy groups, social and physical activity groups run by the third sector, or even volunteering themselves. There's also the option to use helplines, online services to access additional information or therapy. And of course, there are pathways on our high streets where government-funded specialist healthcare is offered via pharmacists, podiatry, optometrists and hearing services, for example. The government vision is that people needing care are informed, empowered and able to access the right professional at the right time. And the committee supports these primary care reforms and the Scottish Government's vision to widen the primary care pathway. But we did find through our inquiry that there are a number of obstacles in achieving that vision. And these include limited public understanding of primary care reform and what it means for them, workforce and capacity issues facing non-GP primary care practitioners, poor signposting to alternative pathways, including inaccurate information about locally available community services, digital exclusion of certain people in our society, and variable ability of digital health and care services, and patient record systems that do not align with one another, with shared data that's easily accessible by multiple healthcare professionals working with shared patients. And the evidence submitted to the inquiry suggests that primary care reform and the reasons for it are still not well understood by the public. Many people still expect to be able to see their GP for absolutely every single health issue, no matter how minor. And limited public awareness about primary care reform seems to be the main cause of this. And some of them, when they're presented with this idea, can often say that they feel fobbed off, when in fact, actually, they've been directed to the right type of care. And one witness told the committee there has been a failure in getting over to the public that general practice is changing, why it's changing and why it needs to change, and what will be put in place to ensure that healthcare needs are fully taken account of. Excuse me. It's imperative that the public understand the reasons behind primary care reform. And rather than preventing them from seeing their GP, this is about making sure they get quick and easy access to the best person to support their needs. And until this is understood, then there will continue to be issues with the public making proper use of the alternative pathways. And the Cabinet Secretary for Health Social Care told us that the Scottish Government has undertaken public information work to inform people about primary care reform. And while the committee welcomes this, we believe that more must be done to increase the general public's understanding of this reform and what it means for them. And we recommend that the Scottish Government implements a coordinated communications plan to look at where that awareness isn't there and to address it. And this included targeted national and local elements to be accompanied by a robust methodology for monitoring and evaluation of those communication efforts. The Scottish Government's intention is that the shift to multidisciplinary working will reduce pressures on services and ensure improved outcomes for patients, while freeing up GPs to spend more time with patients with acute conditions or urgent health concerns in need of their expertise. And as such, a key aim of our inquiry was to establish to what extent primary healthcare professionals, other than GPs, have the capacity to take on more patients and accommodate an increase in referrals. Refocusing GPs to take on an expert medical generalist role is contingent on the recruitment of a range of practitioners into multidisciplinary teams, or MDTs, as I'll refer to them from now on. From the start of the COVID-19 pandemic, Audit Scotland reported that health and social care partnerships were having difficulties in recruiting and retaining practitioners within the GP practice MDTs, and the inquiry also highlighted a shortage in available capacity in non-GP primary healthcare professions, including pharmacy, audiology and psychiatry. Yet, some bodies, like Optometry Scotland, claimed that they had untapped capacity and the ability to take on more referrals. And of course, we didn't have absolutely every single discipline in front of us. So I wonder how many more are out there like Optometry Scotland. The committee has concerns in the short term that workforce constraints and recruitment delays will limit the capacity of these non-GP professions to take on these increased referrals. And the danger there is if those referrals aren't successful, then your patient may not want to use alternative pathways in the future and will revert back to their GP. The committee firmly believes that the better recruitment and retention of professionals is crucial to the success of alternative pathways, notwithstanding the workforce pressures that we all know about. And also, I want to say that accelerated training and recruitment to increase workforce capacity is essential to this, but also to make these varied career routes known to young people who express an interest in healthcare as early as secondary school. Now moving on to what we have termed, for ease of reference, the single electronic patient record. This has long been seen as having the potential to transform multidisciplinary team working, giving people consistent access to the best care by allowing seamless transition between services. And throughout this, and actually other inquiries that we've undertaken, the committee has heard that access to data across different health specialities can be difficult, inconsistent and time-consuming, leading to frustration for practitioners and patients. And there was broad agreement amongst many contributing to the inquiry for need of better integration. The Cabinet Secretary said that work's already underway to produce a single patient electronic record, but we noticed that it's incumbent on him and the government to accelerate that work. Now, since the report's been out there, I've appeared on quite a few roundtables on this issue, and it might not be a single record, but a single interface which leads to systems being tied up. So maybe we need to calibrate our language around that. Practitioners should not have to log into multiple systems that do not talk to one another. And patients should expect that a range of clinicians who treat them should be able to see the right information about the patient in front of them, and a patient should not have to recount their story over and over to different people. And that could be, as I said, a single interface that brings together records. And the commitment to do this is most welcome. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's response to our report, working together to address these challenges. And I hope even by doing this inquiry that we have put it out there that is a live discussion about the access to alternative pathways and the better use of alternative pathways, and continue to make the reforms to make this process seamless for patients. And I hope that this will enable us to give the better health outcomes that we all want primary care reform to deliver for the Scottish public. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Martin. Could I remind all those members who are wishing to speak in the debate to please check that they have pressed the request to speak buttons. Thank you. I now call on Minister Marie Todd. Around 8 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you, members. As the Public Health Minister, I really welcome the chance to open this debate on alternative pathways to primary care. I also want to commend the committee for undertaking its timely inquiry into a topic of such high importance, and thank the many stakeholders and members of the public whose views informed the committee's final report. My portfolio means I am all too aware of the health challenges that Scotland faces. And as the front door of the NHS, primary care in the heart of our communities is at the forefront of our efforts to tackle those challenges. Primary care has significantly changed in the last few years because since 2018, we have committed over £500 million to employ many more healthcare professionals to work in multidisciplinary teams. Now, this has been a major culture shift from a model of care where the doctor is often the first point of contact to one where patients will benefit from access to a whole team of health professionals. In general practice, this means an increasing number of patients receive the care that they need from pharmacists, advanced practitioner nurses, mental health workers, physiotherapists, and community link workers. Through our reforms, we've now recruited 3,220 of these professionals to work in primary care multidisciplinary teams since 2018. And in the wider primary care system, more patients access the care and advice they need from community pharmacists. And at the same time, we remain committed to increasing the number of GPs in Scotland by 800 by the end of 2027. We envisage a person-centred primary care system where GPs occupy the role of expert medical generalist, supported by a multidisciplinary team providing holistic care to patients. It's important to recognise the commitment from our skilled workforce that has made this culture change possible, and I really welcome the committee's recognition of the hard work that's involved. This fits into our wider reform agenda within primary care, with the aim of transforming the system to ensure that people are seeing the right professional at the right time. Reforms to improve patient experience are underway across Scotland, from the new GP contract and its expansion of multidisciplinary teams in general practice, including new or reimagined roles such as community link workers or care navigators. At the centre of all this work is a commitment to ensure that patients and their experience of primary care come first. Certainly.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. Are we aware of how many whole-time equivalent GPs are currently delivering NHS primary care? And are we aware how many whole-time equivalent community link workers are currently working across Scotland?
Minister. So I can certainly get you that data. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will include it in his summing up. It's certainly possible. I know that we have increased the number of GPs working in Scotland and that we have, as we've said many times, we have more health professionals of all kinds per head of population working in Scotland than other parts of the UK. One of the most important innovations that we've seen in primary care, and one that I'm especially interested in, is a move away from purely medical model of care. We know that many of the forces that shape a person's health and well-being issues are their social and economic circumstances. That's where community link workers in general practice and other social prescribing professionals in other community settings have played such a key role. Having specialist staff who can work with an individual to get to the heart of their experiences and then identify and help them to access the community support, financial help or practical guidance through the system that they need, not only benefits that individual, but it helps to ensure that clinical staff are free to focus on those cases that need a clinical approach. Their introduction was timely and they played a truly invaluable role within their communities during the pandemic and demonstrated an admirable ability to adapt to a rapidly developing situation. I was also pleased to see the acknowledgement of their work, not just from the committee, but also several independent research and evaluation studies. We're extremely grateful for the efforts of our community link workers during a challenging time and will continue to support their work, which forms a key part of our recovery from the pandemic. We've developed other roles within primary care to help to guide patients through that complex system. Our care navigators are absolutely key in this regard. As front of house staff, they're often a patient's first encounter with primary care. And in recognition of the importance of this role, we're working to both upskill our care navigators and ensure that these changes are communicated to the public through the Receptionist campaign, which was launched earlier this year. as well as developing a more varied workforce, there are now more diverse pathways and methods for people to be able to access care and support. Telephone consultations have long been part of general practice, but the pandemic has certainly increased their use. Other changes arose from digital innovations, which were often accelerated by the pandemic. We're working to ensure that patients have as many user-friendly options to access support as possible. Increases in funding have allowed NHS 24 to move from a predominantly out-of-hours service to one that operates 24/7. People can access telephone support through a number of pathways, including the Mental Health Hub, the Police Scotland pathway for those in mental health distress, the Wellbeing Helpline and Urgent Care pathway. An increasing number of digital pathways are available to patients, and we're continuing to roll out GP.Scot, a user-friendly website which provides practices with consistent NHS website for patients to access up-to-date health information, and which will support online prescription ordering. NHS Inform, which was established in collaboration with Public Health Scotland, has seen monthly usage of up to 12 million site visits a month to access the up-to-date self-help advice and guidance on offer. That's a phenomenal resource. The experience of the pandemic increased many people's familiarity with these digital pathways, and we are working to fill any gaps in digital literacy to prevent any inequality of access. Now, I'm mindful of the fact that not everyone will benefit equally from these changes. What for one person is a positive ability to choose the care they feel they need, it might just feel like a confusing array of options to another person, which might create anxiety or dissuade them from seeking the help that they need. And we're very aware of the need to avoid change which might unintentionally widen health inequalities. Of course, new pathways to care and an expanded workforce have needed considerable investment, and the key enabler for multidisciplinary teams has been the Scottish Government's Primary Care Improvement Fund. The fund has continuously grown since its introduction in 2018, and to embed the progress that's been made and to expand upon it, we've increased its funding to a new record level of £170 million for the year 2022-23. This will form a minimum budgeted position, ensuring continuity of funding going forward. The committee's report highlighted areas where our reform agenda has delivered improvement for patients, as well as areas where we need to continue our collective efforts. I think all of us in the chamber today are realistic that this winter will bring unprecedented challenges across the whole health and care system. But these tests should not lessen our commitment to ensure that we are doing all that we can with the resources at our disposal to improve health outcomes through offering patients alternative routes to care that they need. I welcome today's debate as an opportunity for us to reaffirm our commitment to ensuring that patients and their experience sit at the heart of primary care, and that primary care sits at the heart of our health system. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Sandhya Gohani. Around 7 minutes, please, Dr. Gohani.
Primary care is the backbone of the NHS, and it is at breaking point. Increased demands, limited capacity. It's a perpetual extreme winter. The expectations being placed on GPs and their practices are causing burnout, demoralisation, and ultimately forcing doctors to leave a profession they love. This is a typical Monday in GP surgery. I'm in for about 8 to start with paperwork, and believe me, there's a lot to plough through. In the background, I hear the volley of phones ringing and our fantastic surgery staff handling call after call, who also deal with an awful lot of abuse. They are really under the cosh. By about 8:30, I've started seeing patients. Some will be struggling in pain on a long waiting list for surgery. Others have chronic conditions like COPD or diabetes. There might be a happy mum-to-be, but there might also be patients who need to be seen by a specialist in hospital immediately. As a GP, you can't afford to miss a sign that someone is going into crisis. By lunch, I've had about 30 patient contacts, and after stretching my legs at a house call and catching some fresh air, it's back to the surgery. And over the afternoon, I'll usually have about another 20 patient contacts. And during the course of the day, I'll be checking blood results from the lab, overseeing other clinical staff, including advanced nurse practitioners, allied health professionals and paramedics. There'll be questions from pharmacists. And what about repeat prescriptions? Well, in Scotland, all practices have an online request system, or the vast majority do. And unfortunately, each and every prescription must be wet signed. We must sign it with a pen. I do about 300 of these a day. Now, this day is typical for GPs across our country. So alternative pathways to patient care provide a vital way of alleviating the burden on overstretched GPs and other healthcare professionals. I appreciate today we're focused on primary care pathways, but we should be mindful of the wider NHS that GPs' practices are part of. Primary care cannot and does not function in isolation. BMA Scotland has been clear that NHS is struggling under workload pressures and workforce issues. Pressures that doctors were used to dealing with in the winter are now affecting the NHS all year round, and staff feel they're working in a perpetual winter. And in terms of general staff welfare, consider the surveys by the Medical and Dental Defence Union of Scotland. 78% of junior doctors in Scotland have experienced burnout. 42% say a lack of access to nutritious food at work was a contributing factor. And 66% report they fear patient safety is at risk when hungry and tired. And this is really worrying, and it's symptomatic of a management culture that does not prioritise frontline healthcare workers. Dr. Andrew Buse, chair of BMA Scottish GP Committee, says failure to support general practice now could have dire consequences for patient care across the country this winter. He goes on to explain that the Scottish Government pledged a £30 million sustainability support package for general practice to be paid in two instalments. The trouble is, last month, the BMA were informed that the second £15 million was being cut to £10 million. That announcement came shortly after more than £50 million intended to support development of health board teams across GP practices, pharmacists, nurses, physios, mental health specialists, was withdrawn. Turning to alternative pathways to primary care, we need to be frank and ask the question, are we doing enough to both provide and communicate alternatives to the GP as the first port of call? Let's consider high street optometrists, who are well equipped with highly specialised equipment to monitor and treat eye issues. Yet a lack of funding is a barrier for these high street specialists to act as an alternative pathway. According to Optometry Scotland, with additional funding, the sector would be able to offer an enhanced range of services, and will be able to do so, which will ease pressure on not only general practice, but also our secondary care. Then there's link workers. Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership said the recruitment of community link workers is stymied by a lack of funding. On social prescribing, Alison Leach of Scottish Social Prescribing Network said a lack of leadership in Scotland is holding social prescribing back. She said no one, sadly, is taking charge of social prescribing. That is where Scotland falls down. In England, there is a head of social prescribing in the NHS, and Wales that is dealt with through public health. The Scottish Government is aware of this problem. And dentistry. The Cabinet Secretary, by cutting the funding multiplier paid to dentists, is presiding over the death of NHS dentistry in Scotland. In Scotland, the BBC reported in August that 82% of NHS dental practices are now not accepting any new adult patients, and 79% are now not accepting new child patients. Now let's turn to communication. The Scottish Government talks about promoting alternative pathways like going direct to opticians, physios, podiatrists, pharmacists for support and even treatment, but the public are largely in the dark about this. According to the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, there is a lack of public awareness for patients using alternative pathways. There's been no meaningful national publicity around changes to the GP practice team and the roles of different professionals within the team. People only become aware of this when they're directed to the pharmacist, for example, as part of routine contact. The Scottish Conservatives want to work constructively on alternative pathways and get these flowing. We would invest 11% of the overall NHS budget into general practice by the end of this parliament. We would also increase the number of training places to deliver 800 more GPs as promised by 2027, and ensuring all GPs are supported by a multidisciplinary team. I will.
Emma Harper.
Some of what you're saying is actually really interesting, and some of it is in the report, but it seems like what you're proposing is not what the report was about. I'm just really interested in some clarity about what part of the report you're referring to.
Sandish Gohani.
I'm referring to the professionals that we speak to on a daily basis. I'm referring to the professionals that I'm in contact with on a daily basis. This is about alternative pathways. This is not purely about the report that was produced. So if we did this by having this increased budget to GPs, that would enable GPs to offer longer appointments to those who needed them. And we want to see alternative pathways rolled out to ease the pressure on GPs. And we would train more independent prescribers to enable pharmacists to treat a wider range of common conditions. And we want to see social prescribing embedded in primary care, including rolling out community link workers and links to advice services more widely, like Citizens Advice Bureau, which makes a huge difference when embedded within primary care. I want to draw members to my register of interest as a practicing NHS GP.
Thank you, Dr. Gohani, and I now call on Carol Mochan. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms. Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I take this opportunity to thank all my colleagues on the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee for the work put into the report. I am pleased to open for Scottish Labour. My party fully supports the report, and Scottish Labour looks forward to seeing its recommendations come to fruition. There is a lot here that the government must act upon, and if they fail to do so, then they are letting down many people who would benefit from this great reform. I am confident with the right approach and goodwill, we can take into account the testimony of experts and the public on matters as important as self-referral and patient records, and in doing so make Scotland a real pioneer in championing alternative pathways to primary care. A key takeaway from the report is the fact that the Scottish Government has failed to explain and promote its vision for primary care and how it will adequately reform, inform patients of how to access this directly. That is something we heard time and time again at committee by people who deal with patients day in and day out. The narrative spun by the government that there is a wide public awareness of reforms to primary care is simply not true, and that is backed up in the report. Very few patients fully understand the self-referral process, and that it is in large part due to a failure of properly informing the public of these changes and ways that they can access and make sense of this. And we must do better on those points. Whether I'm in Dumfries or Thurso, the way to which I might self-refer varies significantly from location to location and from category to category. And we need to help people to understand the processes in their areas so that they can seek the services that they need. For instance, while the option to self-refer to pharmacists, opticians and dentistry is reasonably well understood in many areas, there is far less public awareness of the option to self-refer to other services such as audiology or mental health services. And interestingly, given that mental health backlog is growing day by day, it does strike me that changes in this area could have a great benefit to so many people who are struggling across Scotland, and it would not be particularly costly to the public purse to help people to navigate that system for mental health and wellbeing support. Key to all of these blockages is, of course, the complete lack of a single electronic patient record. And we heard that time and time again and was referred to by the convener of the committee. Having this would streamline the process by which people are referred to and self-refer to the alternative pathways to primary care. It is probably the single most consistent recommendation that we heard during the creation of the report. And whilst it is no doubt has serious logistical barriers, it can be overcome, and we must do better in this area. Until this issue is resolved, wider understanding and use of these pathways will be limited, which begs the question, why is it not the top priority of the government? It has to be, and I ask the Minister to perhaps respond directly to this in his closing remarks. Commitments were made about workforce numbers and increasing the capacity surrounding primary care by this government. And, time and time again, they have been met they haven't been met in any serious way. So it's perfectly understandable that services which deal with referrals and advice are often overwhelmed, and understaffing leads to sort of an unfair perception to the public of the services. And we did hear that as we collected our evidence about the way in which the public interacted with people providing the services, particularly in these new pathways. We cannot expect a first-class health service when staff are sort of overworked, overtired, and the patients and service users coming through are not fully aware of how the service works. I have no doubt that the prevailing economic climate makes life difficult for all aspects of our NHS, not least surrounding staffing, but the cuts announced last week, I don't think, are justified. The £400 million was slashed from key health and social care budgets. The direct impact of that will be incredibly harmful for some of the most vulnerable people in need of care and make the work of this report all the more difficult. It seems remarkable to me that on the same day that the Scottish Government launched an awareness campaign encouraging people to get the right care in the right place, the SNP ministers cut the primary care budget by £65 million and the mental health by £38 million. The actual reality of these cuts to ordinary people is devastating and makes it very difficult to do their job of building sustainable first-class services. Yeah, of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Carol Mockin for taking intervention during what I think is a really helpful speech. But what I would say to Carol Mockin is if we have to mitigate £650 million worth of inflationary pressure, plus we have to give a fair pay deal to NHS workers, if we don't reprofile that money from somewhere, where else do we take that money from in this financial year?
Carol Mockin.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the intervention. I think he will know that I absolutely agree. One of the biggest challenges that we face in Scotland is the current climate of austerity from the Tories and the Tory UK government. But I also think we have to have more honesty in this Parliament about some of the inaction of the SNP and some of the inability to really have a vision of how we can make changes happen. So I think it is really important that the health team look at what can be done as opposed to constantly talking about what happens because of Westminster and the Tories. So I want them to have a vision and talk about the things that they can do. There are inflationary pressures and I understand that. One of the biggest things that we could do, of course, is when we get the chance, is make sure that we do get a Labour government, and I would ask those benches to help with that if they get the chance at all. As I have said, Scottish Labour are committed to getting primary care right for both patients and staff. In closing, I would ask that the government considers that they look again at the cuts and that they look again to make sure that we can make way with the report as it's highlighted and the excellent outcomes that we could have from it in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Mockin. And I now call on Willie Rennie. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
I'll come to this pretty impressive committee report, but the context we just simply cannot ignore. I've never seen primary care in the state that it is now. Patients calling repeatedly to get an appointment day after day after day. Doctors under incredible strain, often burnt out. Many leaving the profession or going part-time, practices closing down, all of which puts more strain on those who remain. Even pharmacies are closing down. The ramifications on the rest of the NHS are evident too. Ambulances queued up outside hospitals, long waits at E&E, long waits for treatment, even longer waits for mental health treatment. And social care, thousands of people without a care package, stuck at home or stuck in hospital, which also compounds the problem of the NHS. And now the nurses are on the verge of a strike. They never go on strike. And that's how bad it's become. The situation is incredibly dark. The BMA talk of breaking point, burnout, demoralisation and departure. Yes, the pandemic had an impact. I'll agree with the Health Secretary on that. But the government's negligence and complacency over many, many years are far bigger factors. The former NHS Scotland Chief Executive Paul Gray says these problems have been building for years, well before the pandemic. Let's remind us what he said. The current system was going to be overwhelmed regardless of COVID. The virus has simply brought the date of that event forward. And the reasons? after 15 years of this government include inadequate reforms, poor workforce planning for the multidisciplinary team, refusing to recruit enough GPs for years, cutting the number of nurse training places, failing to eradicate the delayed discharge that they promised in 2016. You should listen to this list. This is an important list. Undervaluing the social care year after year after year, delaying the mental health strategy and the spending associated with it. Action 15 of the Mental Health Strategy committed £35 million for additional mental health workers in A&E, police custody suites and GP practices. But ministers now can't even tell us whether this target has been met. And the explanation in a parliamentary answer is the government doesn't hold the data. I'll take an intervention from the minister.
Minister.
Thank you. I wonder, when listening to this litany of failures from the SNP government, whether the member reflects at all on his party's role in bringing us austerity when they went into government with the Tories in 2010, brought us austerity, which, as we now all know, academics have proven, has shortened the lives of people living in Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
Pardon? At some point, we must pray, at some point, that this government will accept responsibility for its own powers, decisions over the last 15 years, including what we heard today about people who have died in hospital because of this government's inadequate performance over the last 15 years. Sorry, I don't have the time. No, not just now. I'm sorry, I'm not taking intervention. And from my discussions with the police and GPs, there's very little evidence that these mental health workers in these various places have actually been delivered. And to compound the problem in primary care, we've heard the issue of the cuts of £5 million to the sustainability support package, just at the time that primary care is absolutely on its knees. And the £50 million intended to support the development of health board teams with GP practices, including pharmacists, nurses, physiotherapists
and mental health specialists. Mr Rennie, please resume your seat. Point of order, Gillian Martin.
As the convener of the committee that produced the report, sometimes it's very frustrating when members come into a committee debate which we've secured time for and don't speak to the motion or the report. Can I seek your advice on whether they should?
I thank Ms Martin for her point of order. The debate is indeed focusing on the report, the inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care, but obviously that is quite a wide subject area and it really is not for the chair to, in effect, police the contributions from members to the extent that they have relevance to the broad subject at hand. But of course, I'm sure that Mr Rennie has heard the concern from the convener and would wish to specifically address perhaps some issues in the committee's report, which is the subject of the debate today. Thank you.
Yeah, I can understand why SNP members don't want to talk about this stuff. I can understand that, because the failure over the last 15 years has been lamentable, and it has been a disgrace. And of course, it has a direct impact on the delivery of alternative pathways to primary care. If you don't have the core service working properly, then of course you're not going to be able to change the service in the way that the committee quite rightly identifies necessary. This is something I've passionately believed in for a long time. I've done a lot of work on social prescribing, on making sure we have mental health professionals alongside GPs in GP practices. I've done a lot of work on all these areas. But I have to say, the context is deeply damaging. And for this government and its SNP backbenchers not want to talk about it, I can understand, but that's one thing I am certainly going to do, because I've got a responsibility to make sure that people understand the failings of this government. Now, saying that, I'm going to give the Health Secretary a bit of credit. The Health Secretary responded to the... The Health Secretary responded positively to the calls from the BMA to make sure the pension contributions with a new REC scheme made sure that they weren't deterred from working extra hours, because they were effectively paying for the privilege to work for the NHS. And now, thankfully, the Minister has agreed to that change, and it means we'll be able to free up extra capacity for doctors to help the NHS. So it's good change. It's a positive change. I've also got some other positive suggestions that the Minister could adopt as well, in terms of resolving the pay dispute with the nurses would be good, retain and recruit the promised 800 GPs by 2027, sort out the social care problems so fundamental to the operation of our National Care Service, deliver the mental health strategy and the 800 additional workers promised, lead a programme to help inform patients how to access primary care with alternative pathways, convener, to make sure that that system works too, improve the easy access and knowledge and provision of alternative services, including through social prescribing. I hope that the Minister does all of those things. And I do support the committee's recommendations on self-referral, on ALICE, on the role of the receptionist, on the single patient record, on the digital improvements. I'm an enthusiastic person about these things. I'm an enthusiastic advocate for those areas. But health professionals are too. But they have very little time to breathe at the present time, and that's why all of these other issues need to be resolved. And I want to conclude with a letter I received from the Ostermuchty Health Centre in my constituency. They talk of the system being fragile, bigger list sizes but fewer staff, and astonishment at the cuts to funds. Finally, they say, in future, when your constituents complain to you about the lack of GP appointments and services at Ostermuchty Health Centre, we hope you will be honest with them about the limitations of general practice in Scotland and who is responsible for the policy decisions which have led to and exacerbated the crisis. I hope I have done so today.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate, and I call Paul McLennan to be followed by Sue Webber. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Gillian Martin and our committee colleagues for bringing forward this report, and to the clerks for their help. Also, I want to focus on the role of social prescribing in the time I have today. I've met with the Public Health Minister, Marie Todd, on a number of occasions, as well as hosting a parliamentary reception with the Scottish Social Prescribing Network. I attended my many organisations from the sector, and I thank the Minister for our for meeting. As part of the inquiry, the committee was interested to understand levels of awareness of social prescribing amongst both patients and health practitioners, and to what extent effective use is currently being made of social prescribing. Social prescribing is described as a means of enabling health professionals to refer people to a range of local, non-clinical services. In its National Clinical Strategy for Scotland in 2016, the Scottish Government noted that the multiple long-term health conditions can result in complex needs, many of which would be best addressed by social rather than medical interventions. To deliver that vision, that people to live more years in good health and that we reduce inequalities in health life expectancy, the Scottish Government argues our efforts need to shift towards even greater prevention and early intervention to local community-based support across Scotland. In 2019, the Session 5 Health and Sport Committee published its inquiry report, Social Prescribing, Physical Activity as an Investment, Not a Cost. The report explored opportunities and challenges for social prescribing in Scotland. This report concluded that social prescribing has clear benefits for the Scottish population and for health services. Social prescribing and primary prevention approaches can help in preventing long-term conditions and dependence on pharmaceutical prescriptions. They also have the potential to ease the pressure on existing health and social care services, as well as reducing waiting times, unplanned admissions to hospital and delayed discharges. The report also noted there were costs involved that they should be considered as an investment. So what's the potential for social prescribing? Many of the witnesses contributing to... Yeah?
Craig Hoy.
For giving way. Will he...
You've not got your card in, Craig.
Yes, but I don't think the card is in. Thank you. Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Mr McLennan for giving way? Does he recognise that in many instances social prescribing will focus on sport and leisure? And does he share my concern about the real terms cuts to council budgets over the last decade, which has impeded council's ability to deliver those services that can be used in a social prescribing context?
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, I think it's delivered in many ways. Sport, you know, my involvement, I've been involved in football for 15, 20 years in a professional manner and other issues. It's not only councils, it's also the third sector, and I'll come on to that a little bit later on. I want to come back to about many of the witnesses contributing to this inquiry identified significant potential for social prescribing to patients, particularly for those presenting problems that are rooted in non-medical issues. For clients, for example, decreased social isolation, improved new housing, financial and benefits issues being addressed, and increased confidence, awareness and empowerment. By using local resources, people can become more connected to their community and increases their sense of belonging. For GPs, reduced patient contact with medical services, providing more options for patients, raising awareness of non-clinical services and increased GP productivity. and further evidence, Claire Cook from Spring Social Prescribing and Scottish Social Prescribing Network argued that it should not be a one-size-fits-all approach to social prescribing. Programmes must be able to be responsive to local needs. We've heard already about Alison Leach from Edinburgh Community Link Worker Programme, arguing as well that we need a clear overall lead on social prescribing and efforts to try and promote that. The committee heard evidence that mapping work currently being undertaken by both Social Prescribing Network and Scottish Community Link Worker Networks would provide a clearer overview of a social prescribing provision across the country. Current mapping shows that most local authority areas have social prescribing programmes in existence. The Cabinet Secretary himself mentioned that he is a real believer in the ability of social prescribing to have a positive impact on people. He also expects to hope that there would be more people access social prescribing, the more we'll see its value and promote its benefit to others. So what are the barriers to greater uptake? Evidence to the inquiry suggests that at least some of the barriers to the greater use of social prescribing still remain. The committee heard that social prescribing described as the biggest cultural shift in healthcare and medicine we have had at the same time. They acknowledged that these services are not universally available throughout the country, and this is a barrier to promoting them at a national level. The committee also noted there is no national lead on social prescribing, given that the responsibility is shared between two Scottish Government ministerial portfolios. The committee commends the work currently being undertaken by social prescribing networks to map the availability of social prescribing pathway across the country. So what next for social prescribing? The potential for social prescribing is endless, but it must be embedded fully in health and social care to achieve that potential. We must have robust evaluation processes to measure the impact it has on individual lives and on communities. We need to work in partnership with the third sector to provide most of the community services as social prescribing can only be as good as the services able to refer to. We need primary care and the third sector to work closer together to meet the challenges facing society. We need to work with social prescribing medical students to embed social prescribing into the medical degree so that the GPs of the future can see early on that they have a toolbox of multidisciplinary professions available in order to achieve the best outcomes for patients. The Welsh Government has recently carried out an ambitious consultation on framework for social prescribing, and England and Northern Ireland already have a framework in place. Presiding officer, in conclusion, the social prescribing movement in Scotland is being recognised as a part of a global social prescribing alliance to the existing networks. The important part here is, though, an overriding structure designed for Scotland, by Scotland and for the people of Scotland, and ownership is essential to ensuring the momentum is built upon. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call Sue Webber to be followed by Evelyn Tweed. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Webber.
Thank you, presiding officer. I'm speaking today as somebody who was a member of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee when this inquiry started. And I want to acknowledge and thank all of those that gave evidence, my fellow committee members, and for what was a very eye-opening and informative time that I spent there. In both the formal and the informal sessions, most of the informal sessions I found to be even more relevant and revealing. It was so thank you to everyone for making that so impactful. But as the British Medical Association has said, primary care is the backbone to the NHS, and it is at breaking point, with increasing demands and limited capacity. The expectations being placed on GPs and their practices are causing burnout, demoralisation, and ultimately forcing doctors to leave the profession. So it is very important that we had and took part in this inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care, which after all is for patients, it's a pathway to access a diagnosis and or treatment. Pressures that doctors are used to dealing with in winter are now affecting them all year round. Staff feel like they are working in perpetual winter, as Dr. Gohani said earlier, and have been for the past 18 months. The SNP government are not doing enough to provide these alternative pathways right now for that primary care workforce. This makes the report we are debating and discussing today even more timely and even more relevant. And that's why all of the recommendations must be implemented. One of my constituents wrote to me about his struggles to get an appointment to get that key diagnosis. He did get to see his GP, but what came after was a path of confusion and challenging timelines for him. He was initially referred to the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh by his GP, as I said, who was able to access, but he received a letter saying that he'd been triaged by a professor as general. And when he inquired what this meant, he found out it might mean a six-month wait to see a cardiologist. I'm just curious and forgive me for being maybe a bit too controversial, that I'm concerned that some of these pathways are being used as a stalling tactic to prevent people accessing acute care. Understandably, my constituent was concerned, so he sought an appointment at the Spire Hospital and saw a cardiologist within a week. But that came at high cost. And after an extensive echocardiogram and ECG, he was diagnosed with a stenosed heart valve and heart failure, which can be very serious. Thankfully, after an adjustment to his medication, he is feeling a lot better, and his cardiologist has agreed to see him again at his NHS clinic at St John's Hospital at the beginning of March. Now, my constituent is in a rare cohort, because he does understand self-referrals and he does understand how the process of the NHS acute and primary care works. And he's also very aware of the challenges that all of these healthcare professionals are facing. But he knew that he needed a diagnosis. People should not have to seek this route to access healthcare and get the treatments and the diagnosis that are needed to save their lives. My constituent was luckily able to do this, but so many people are not. The consequences are that Scotland's healthcare is turning into an unfair two-tier system, depending on what you can afford. This is not the alternative pathway that we're here to discuss today, but that's the reality of what we have. The NHS staffing crisis is all around us, and there is one branch of the service which we could do much more to alleviate the pressure on hospitals, and that is our primary care practitioners, the backbone and gateway to the system, as the Minister stated in her remarks. It's in every bit of crisis as the care system. GPs, allied health professionals, nurses, podiatrists, the list is extremely extensive. But again, the number of qualified medical staff can't keep pace with the growing demand, both from an ageing population and the expansion of housing estates, with the number of GPs virtually unchanged at 3,600 full-time equivalents, while the population has risen to 5.47 million and expected to grow another 10,000 in the next 6 years. Housing developers happily commit to building new GP surgeries in their sprawling new estates without any idea where the qualified medics will be found. And why should they? As 5,000 homes go up around Winchborough, it's not the responsibility of Calla or Taylor Wimpey to source doctors and nurses. Scotland's GP workforce has shrunk in 6 years leading up to the pandemic. And in 2017, the SNP government pledged to increase the number of GPs in Scotland by 800 by 2027. But they are not on track to achieve this. We want to see an increase in training places to deliver more than 800 GPs promised by 2027 and ensure that all GPs are supported by that wider and invaluable multidisciplinary team. And that would enable GPs to offer longer appointments to see these who need them. We would train more independent prescribers to enable pharmacists to treat a wider range of common conditions, and we do want to see social prescribing embedded in primary care, included by rolling out the community link workers and links to advice services more widely available. Alternative pathways to primary care provide a vital way to alleviate the burden on our overstretched GPs and other healthcare professionals. The pandemic may not have been the genesis for all these issues, but its shockwaves have exacerbated them on the state of urgency and crisis that we're facing now. We need more work to see the alternative pathways rolled out to ease the pressure on GPs and take cognizance of all the recommendations in the report. They are all welcomed and we support them today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Webber. I now call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Sarah Boyack. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Tweed.
Sir, I was very pleased to be involved in the Alternative Pathways to Primary Care inquiry, and thank you to everyone who engaged with the committee on this work. Whilst recent research by the Nuffield Trust shows that Scotland has record numbers of GPs and the highest number per head of population in the UK, with 76 GPs per 100,000 people, compared to a UK average of 60, there is no doubt that they are under pressure. Alternative pathways to primary care are freeing up resources. For example, local pharmacies can now treat minor conditions that would have required a GP appointment through the Pharmacy First Service. In autumn 2022, pharmacy teams have already carried out over 3 million consultations for minor illnesses whilst referring under 5% to other healthcare services. And I can use my local health board to demonstrate the benefits of alternative pathways. The population is growing and the number of residents aged over 65 is increasing even more rapidly. However, already NHS Forth Valley have been able to extend GP appointments from 10 to 15 minutes through, for example, piloting the use of physiotherapists and mental health nurses in local GP practices. Children are also being vaccinated in the community by dedicated immunisation teams. And there's an innovative website supporting social prescribing for both patients and healthcare staff, providing details of a range of alternative resources. As part of the 2018 GP contract, over 3,000 whole-time equivalent multidisciplinary teams have been recruited, including pharmacists, mental health workers, and physios. This has great potential to ease the pressure on GPs and promote greater use of alternative pathways through the creation of MDTs carrying out primary care functions in a patient-centred manner. However, I won't at this present point, but maybe soon. However, key elements of the contract have been delayed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. As the convener noted, the committee saw evidence from the public through a survey which highlighted a lack of awareness of services to be a problem. GP services have been the clear first point of call for healthcare for a long time, and the study revealed high awareness of opportunities to self-referral for some services, such as dentists and optometrists, but much lower for others such as audiology and mental health. It's clear that many people highly value GP services and felt dismissed when sent on an alternative path. The Right Care, Right Place campaign, which included radio and television broadcasts, as well as a booklet sent to all households across Scotland in January 2021, has not fully addressed public understanding or acceptance of, for example, the enhanced role of GP receptionists and options for self-referral. Perhaps a similar campaign needs to be rerun, learning the lessons highlighted to support this significant cultural shift. I am encouraged by the Cabinet Secretary's response and openness to continued dialogue with the committee on this matter. I am pleased that the Scottish Government is also exploring the potential of standardising training for administration staff working in primary care in order to improve relationships between admin staff and patients. It's also good to see that after such a challenging few years, £8 million is being invested by the Scottish Government to support the physical, mental and emotional needs of the workforce. And thanks to the reckless and self-serving decisions of the Westminster Conservative Government, the Scottish health budget, and I hear groans across the chamber, but the Scottish health budget is now worth around £650 million less than it was in December 2021. Yep. In addition, austerity has had a terrible effect on the lives and shortened the lives of Scottish people. And our committee knows this because we took evidence on this. The Scottish Government's promotion of alternative pathways to primary care cannot make up for Westminster's incompetence and austerity, but it can...
Could you please resume your seat, Ms Tweed, and point of order, Tess White.
Yes. I didn't know that was in the committee report. Thank you.
Sorry, Ms White, I'm not clear what that
I'm just questioning the relevance.
Relevance about what?
The relevance of Westminster and... the UK government has no bearing on the committee report. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White, for your point of order. As I said in response to Ms Martin in terms of her point of order, I, as the chair, am not here to police the contributions of members to the extent that they bear relevance in broad brush to the subject at hand. And that is what I said in response to Ms Martin's concerns about a previous speaker's contribution, and that is the answer I would give to Ms White. Thank you. Ms Tweed, please continue.
Thanks, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'll just resume that last point. The Scottish Government's promotion of alternative pathways to primary care cannot make up for Westminster's incompetence and austerity, but it can help to better distribute resources and capacity in healthcare to ensure everyone gets the care they need from the most appropriate practitioner. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Tweed. I now call Sarah Boyack to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do want to thank the committee for their report because it's vital work. And I thought the speeches by Carol Mockin and Willie Rennie were powerful in highlighting the pressures that primary care faces today. In my contribution, I want to make the links between the ambition of identifying alternative pathways to care and delivering in communities across Scotland. And I also want to take the opportunity to join in the discussions we've had in our Constitution, External Affairs and Culture Committee work in terms of the evidence we've received and the work I've been doing with the culture sector, where social prescribing comes up time and time again as crucial for support for people's health and well-being. And on one level, it is inspiring to see the work in our communities. On another level, it has been incredibly frustrating to see the fact that it's now over a decade since the Christie Commission's recommendation on investing in prevention were made. We've not seen fast enough progress, so I very much support the committee's recommendation to map availability across Scotland. I think that's important. When we questioned the Cabinet Secretary for Health at our CEAC evidence session in March, his timetable for action social prescribing was to ensure that by 2026, every GP practice would have access to a mental health and wellbeing service with the aim of helping to grow community mental health resilience and direct social prescribing at a grassroots level. While I welcome the ambition, it's years late, and my frustration is that the cultural sector we have in Scotland is already providing fantastic wellbeing activities targeted to support people and to help their wellbeing, even as the sector faces the perfect storm. But what we don't have is the connecting delivery strategy to make the links between health and culture that we really, really need now. And we know from research that social prescribing works. So we just need to get on with mainstreaming it and making it available to those who need it. So I very much welcome the recommendations from the committee that we're debating today, in particular their acknowledgement that cost is a key barrier for people on low incomes. There was a 2020 Glasgow University report that examined the impact of Links Worker Programme, a social prescribing initiative in areas of high deprivation in Glasgow, and it was designed to address health inequalities. They conducted interviews with community organisations representatives and community links practitioners. And the empirical evidence on the positive impact in areas of deprivation is really important to highlight. Social prescribing allowed people to be engaged who would otherwise not have benefited from services outside formal primary health care. And a powerful quote from the research was, "The challenge is reaching the people who are hardest to reach. The people that don't realise that, although they might be aware of us, they don't realise that we could actually help them." And the study also reported the increase in the need of services happening at the same time we had funding cuts, with organisations left with a massively reduced resource. Projectism is what we call it in the CEAC committee from the evidence we've had, and it's how cultural organisations have described the challenge they face. With rising demand, organisations are focused on getting through the crisis after crisis, but they're not able to do the long-term work building relationships with those who need it. And we know from other research published last year, the challenges social prescribing coordinators are facing following the shift towards delivering services digitally. So there's an awful lot that needs to be addressed now. And I think the thing I really want to bring out is that social prescribing links our health and cultural sectors. And it's absolutely crucial for post-COVID recovery to support people through the pressures and anxiety that is now coming through the cost of living crisis. It really would be a practical way to promote health and well-being now and to support people and to avoid them getting further and further into the health process when actually there's a way to enable them to be supported now. And there's practical work being done now. Over the last 12 months, I've been able to hear from different organisations about the benefits they're delivering with joined-up approaches. I had the pleasure of sponsoring the exhibition reception to celebrate the incredible work Art and Healthcare is doing to improve health and well-being by using visual art in healthcare settings and humanising our medical environments to support staff and patients. Edinburgh University's Prescribe Culture pilot is aimed at increasing access, and their Take 30 brochure is available and free to download. At our recent cross-party group on culture, we heard from those involved in the archive services at the University of Dundee about the huge benefits that it had to them personally in terms of their mental health. And then there was the excellent work of the Tayside Healthcare Arts Trust. And I also want to highlight the fantastic work of National Museum Scotland and their museum socials. For 7 years now, they have been having learning and programmes that look at community engagement team to host museum socials for people living with dementia. It's an informal learning experience. It gives participants access to a range of opportunities to engage both with national collections and with wider social activities. And it also supports their family members. I think the report that Museums Scotland have done about health and wellbeing is absolutely superb. It's definitely well worth reading. And then you've got the work of National Gallery Scotland on access to mindfulness, dementia-friendly access, and a commitment to autism and sensory-friendly access. But it needs to be supported on an ongoing basis, and we need similar projects right across the country so every local community can access them. And although it's not just a question of funding, multi-year and predictable funding is essential, and that's the constant message we get from the cultural sector. Then it's the making links with the health sector. And I very strongly support the committee's call for action to support voluntary sector providers and to support them to address long-term financial viability, because we are in a perfect storm and we need to see the Scottish Government address the issue now. Physical activity prescribing is becoming more common and it's delivering benefits for people now and our health service. But we need to see culture prescribing become legitimate with clear political leadership from ministers as recommended by the committee and their suggestion of work to deliver a targeted communication strategy to raise awareness of the positive impact of social prescribing is really important. And I hope ministers will take that up. Thank you, Presiding
Officer. Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Callaghan.
Thank you. I want to start today by thanking primary care staff and all those who provided evidence to our committee, including patients who told us their own personal stories, as well as the other members of the committee, especially our chair, Gillian Martin. As others have said, primary care really is the absolute backbone of our health service. And one of the things that came up for me was about, you know, what actually is primary care? And when you ask most people, they'll tell you, you know, it's about their GP. But as we've heard today, it's about so, so much more than that. It's the community nurses, it's the physiotherapists, the occupational therapists, it's dentists, end-of-life care, health visitors, and many, many others. And that as well is not forgetting the invisible support staff who back them all up too. As the first point of contact for healthcare for most people, strong primary care is really, really central to an effective and sustainable health service. In general practice too, our GPs, they're busier than they've ever been. The GPs and their teams are striving to meet spiralling patient demand along with establishing key primary care networks. And in Lanarkshire, I know there's been between 40% and 50% increase in the demand for patient appointments. So there's much around the challenges of Brexit, the pandemic, and 12 years of austerity, which have all hit really hard. And now we're also facing current levels of inflation as another threat there too. So the need to reform general practice and deliver these alternative pathways has never been so pressing as it is today. But it's a challenging area for reform too, both here in Scotland and internationally as well. Our access to primary care is deeply affected by many factors, including resources, staffing and planning as well. So there's a lot going on in primary care, and services are working really hard to adapt at a time when resources are already stretched to the limits. That's something that we heard repeatedly throughout the committee. And it's compounding the barriers to sustainable and effective change. But that doesn't mean that we need to slow down. We need to work even harder to make sure that we're meeting these challenges head on. And we also need to be mindful that the public have been asked to adapt to at a time when they've never been more anxious or confused about access to care. And I think many of the public think, you know, this is just a process that has started because of COVID. And we need to get that recognition out there as well, that it's something that started before then. It's not just about a response to that. It's about it being the right thing to do. So, Presiding Officer, transformation is really needed, and the success of our NHS will, to some extent, depend on our ability to increase access and awareness of alternative pathways to primary care. So these alternative pathways can include receiving advice or treatment from allied health professionals, using social prescribing initiatives, accessing websites or using telephone services, and doing that instead of going directly to your GP every time. And the name alternative pathways itself is maybe kind of slightly confusing, as what we're really saying is more about effective pathways to receiving better care, and maybe that's something that we really need to communicate a bit more coherently. During this inquiry, a majority of people didn't really quite understand why we were reforming general practice, and again, that's a message that we need to really, really be talking about. Because our general practice is a community asset that should act as the glue that connects all of our other services and professionals within healthcare, rather than being the kind of single focal point where the patient's dependent on a particular GP. So I want to just touch on three wee bits of the report. It's got so much more in it, and you've heard so much about it today already. But I'm going to speak about community social prescribing, digital opportunities and recruitment challenges a little bit. So firstly, in social prescribing, in some cases, there was an increase in uptake during the pandemic, and the positive comments we got from patients were really good. They noted quicker and better health outcomes. However, the evidence also suggested that some people have still reverted back to their GP practice, and we need to take that on board and recognise that, you know, behaviours are going to take a time to change. In my own constituency in Lanarkshire, the Community Link Workers Programme offers full coverage across all the practices. And in June this year, more than half of Lanarkshire's GP services referred into the GP Community Link Workers Programme. That was just under 300 referrals. And the most common reasons were related to mental health issues. But we know that social prescribing can be effective for physical health and fitness too, and that can have a huge impact going forward. And I really would welcome an update on any plans the Scottish Government has to develop social prescribing further to build on this success, particularly around perhaps having a national lead to help improve delivery. Moving on to digital opportunities, our committee report highlighted that digital progress will be key to transforming healthcare for patients and for health professionals too. And I read the recent Scottish Government report titled Care in the Digital Age, which sets out the delivery plan as we move through into 2023 and the rest of this year. Now, easy-to-use patient apps that provide really nice, easy access to appointments and test results are a huge thing that we all really, really want to see. And a single electronic patient record is another huge thing as well, something that can be accessed by health and care professionals right across the NHS, right across social care, will make a really, really huge difference, not just to them, but to our patients too. However, the reality on the ground is that a lot of time and money is being invested, but a lot of that too is going into IT systems just now. It's about strengthening cyber security. It's about training up staff. And while I recognise these complexities and the level of background work in this area, I do still hope that the Cabinet Secretary can offer a bit of reassurance that developing digital apps and records will be an absolute priority going forward. I know it's challenging, but it's something that's just so vital and so important. Last but not least, I'll briefly mention recruitment. And there is a real this is a really challenging area, as others have mentioned there. However, to touch on some positives, I really welcome the Scottish Government's winter plan that commits to recruiting an additional 1,000 additional staff over the winter season, 750 nurses, 250 support staff. But in closing, Presiding Officer, alternative pathways to primary care can help ease some of the pressures on our GPs and other areas of the NHS. There's a lot of work to do still, and I call
Ms.
the Cabinet Secretary
you must
to
conclude.
Focus on building these pathways and to keep the committee
Thank
in this
you.
Parliament updated.
Thank
Thanks.
You. I call on Gillian Mackay to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As many others have, I would like to start by thanking the clerks, my colleagues on the committee, and to those who gave formal, informal and written evidence to the committee. The way services are delivered has changed significantly over the last few years, with both primary care reform, as we've heard from others, and the pandemic having an impact. In written evidence, the Royal College of Physicians and Surgeons of Glasgow indicated understanding of alternative pathways to healthcare is poor among patients. It noted patients may be aware generally about alternative pathways and may be limited about specific pathways. It may also be guided by personal experience of both practitioners and patients and what is available locally. The Royal Pharmaceutical Society also highlighted limited patient awareness of alternative pathways and multidisciplinary teams. There needs to be greater emphasis put on advertising and normalising the use of multidisciplinary teams and alternative pathways. But this is a particularly acute need ahead of winter to ensure that everyone is getting the help they need. We also need to make sure that the advertisement of alternative pathways reaches everyone. Many don't use social media, some won't see adverts on television because they only use streaming services, so we need to make sure that the ways we communicate these are accessible, clear, and show the multiple pathways people can take to truly ensure that there is a no-wrong-door approach. Glasgow City HSCP argued for action to encourage a change in behaviour from people automatically seeking help from GPs in their first instance. However, it also acknowledged that such changes can take significant amounts of time to become embedded in practice. There was evidence given to the committee of good understanding of how and when to self-refer to dentists, optometrists and pharmacists, but there was a lack of awareness of the full range of services that these practitioners offered. However, audiology is not currently afforded the same level of access. The National Community Hearing Association Scotland outlined current obstacles to self-referral for patients with non-urgent ear and hearing problems. They said the current model of NHS care means each year patients are forced to see their GP for non-medical ear and hearing problems, which can be better managed in primary care audiology settings. It also stated that in some cases the GP in a pathway adds costs without adding value, resulting in an overall loss of scarce NHS resources. This is particularly true for most ear and hearing problems, where primary care audiology is, in the same way as optometrists for eye care problems, much better suited to managing needs, freeing up GP capacity to address medical issues. Many people will experience a hearing loss over the course of their life, and we need to ensure that access to services has parity no matter the sensory issue that people are dealing with. As someone who has a hearing impairment, I may be slightly biased on this, but I can often get easier access to eye tests than I can for primary care support for changes with my hearing. They often don't need support from the hospital audiology team, and being able to refer straight to primary care audiology would save time for both GPs and secondary care teams. I recognise the issues of potential duplication of effort raised by the Royal College of GPs in their evidence. There is always a potential for patients to be signposted or self-referred to a service that doesn't wholly fit the issues they are experiencing. And I'm sure many GPs would say that sometimes the issue that patients come in with isn't exactly what they think it is, but there is an issue of ownership for patients of their own care. There was a suggestion made in evidence of a system to request fast-track follow-up by a GP for patients who need it. And I think this may offer a sensible solution that, if put in place, would need close monitoring and evaluation, including both patients and clinicians. There is a lot to cover in this report, Presiding Officer, and I don't think I can do it justice in my time remaining. But I would like to use the remainder of my time to focus on one of my favourite topics, data. One of the barriers to allowing smooth sharing of data between multidisciplinary teams is the lack of ability to share data easily. Many of our witnesses cited a single electronic patient record, as we've heard from many others this afternoon, as being transformational in allowing seamless access between services. We also heard from patients that this would prevent them from having to retell their story multiple times, particularly for those accessing mental health support or ongoing support because of an impairment. For example, having to retell your story, how you came to experience your symptoms, what led you to accessing the service, is exhausting, sometimes really upsetting and re-traumatising for some. A single patient record is essential, as I said, to ensure we're not re-traumatising people. There are also very practical reasons for single patient records, like being able to take all your information with you when you move, rather than having to request a copy of your records to be sent to your new GP. Thousands of people will move every week out of their current GP practice, and really in 2022 it should be simpler to move your data. I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary indicate at committee that this is a priority, and I would welcome any update he has. Presiding Officer, I'd like to conclude by thanking again everyone who gave evidence to the committee and those who continue to support us in our ongoing work.
Thank you. I call Craig Hoy to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Health and Social Care and Support Committee's report on alternative pathways to primary care highlights a crisis in our primary care sector and makes a number of recommendations that I hope the Scottish Government will act upon. And I would like to thank the committee for this report, which only serves to highlight the challenges facing our NHS and the staff who work within it under this SNP government. The problems are long-running and well-known, and they are well-known to Scottish ministers. Staff are overstretched and undervalued. Routine primary care appointments are being cancelled up and down the country, and many patients struggle to access primary care. Self-referral pathways are not clear and they're not advertised well enough. And the primary care sector is unable to keep up with rising demand due to poor workforce planning by the SNP government. And now, for the first time, nurses, the beating heart of our NHS, are set to strike. In my own region, we see the problems firsthand. GP patients are facing challenges in booking appointments in areas such as Gullen, Port Seton and North Berwick. Pharmacies in Haddington and Galla Shields have faced repeated unscheduled closures. Boots Pharmacy in Haddington frequently has a closed sign pinned to its door. It is shut to patients who are needing prescriptions or access to the services delivered through pharmacies. And these are important pathways, and they should remain open. And in fact, the British Medical Association has warned that primary care in Scotland faces a critical workforce supply problem, and the Scottish Government must need a credible plan. Just last month, in fact, I warned that a rise in unexpected pharmacy closures due to the Scottish pharmacy contract is an issue of concern. The pharmacy contract means that the Scottish Government continues to pay for pharmacies to stay open even when they are closed without any reason. And the Pharmacists Defence Association has warned that some large pharmaceutical chains such as Boots and Lloyds may be exploiting this loophole to maximise profits at the expense of those in need of pharmacy care, and that this is happening without any consequences. But as the report makes clear, the root of this problem yet again is poor workforce planning by this government. So we need to see the SNP government putting in place an adequate strategy to recruit and manage GP retention. It is vital that this government now acts upon that, because in 2019, Audit Scotland warned that by 2027, the Scottish Government's target of recruiting an additional 800 net GPs would not be met. The GPs, Minister, that are coming through the front door are only being offset by those who are leaving. And in a report this year, Audit Scotland continued to warn that recruitment and retention of GPs, and indeed right throughout the health service, should be given more priority by this government. Also, there's the issue of mental health, and signposting within the workplace continues to be poor. Every year, up to 650 people in the UK take their own life due to work-related mental health issues. And a survey from See Me Scotland this year found that 77% of those with poor mental health said they experienced unfair treatment in the workplace because of their mental health. And Support in Mind Scotland's director, Jim Hume, has said, and I quote, "Training staff in mental health can help to break down stigma and discrimination, build awareness and develop skills and enhance confidence." Findings from the project have demonstrated that 91% of people who participated say they have an increased awareness and understanding of mental health following the training, and 87% of participants feel more confident to talk about mental health with their staff and their colleagues. Jim Hume adds, the evidence highlights how mental health training is a valuable resource to build resilience and reduce stigma in the workplace by increasing people's knowledge of mental health, breaking stereotypes and building people's confidence to be a first responder. The committee's report rightly stresses the important role of community link workers and receptionists in primary care in signposting patients, but it is vital that the services are there once that signposting process takes place. And I think there is a concern about government cuts, particularly in relation to the mental health budget. And in the last parliament, the SNP broke their manifesto pledge of recruiting an extra 250 community link workers to GP practices. So could the government make sure that that is a priority to fill those vacancies? Sadly, this is a pattern of empty promises and shallow words by the Health Secretary and his government when it comes to Scotland's health system, and most importantly, those hugely valuable staff that work within it. Mm-hmm. We need action to support primary care and invest in healthcare up and down the country. And when we offer alternative pathways, for example, as I said to Mr. McLennan, through sport and leisure, we must make sure that we properly fund those community organisations and those councils to deliver that, rather than seeing real terms cuts, as we've seen both in good times and also in the turbulent times that we now see. Local health and social care services continue to be decimated by this SNP government. In South Scotland, for example, we've seen the closure of North Berwick's Eddington Cottage Hospital last year, and that was a hospital with whom local GPs worked very closely to make sure that local need was met. That, Minister, took place without any consultation with local residents or primary health care professionals. And we're seeing it writ large now with the SNP's plan to plough ahead with the National Care Service against the advice of third sector organisations and social care experts. And any problems in social care will only add to the further pressures that we see in an already stretched primary care sector. Presiding Officer, this government is ignoring the crisis in primary care and a wider crisis in our NHS. Yet again, its priorities lie elsewhere. The Minister's priorities lie elsewhere. Humza Yousaf has taken his eye off the ball, and it's time he was removed from the pitch.
Thank you. I call Emma Harper, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the committee, I welcome the opportunity to highlight our report and, you know, focus on the report, and it has been interesting to hear others' contributions as well. Our report highlights that primary health is vital to ensuring that people are seen by the most relevant professional for their needs, and it is crucial in relieving pressure from the secondary care, particularly when our NHS is under the most pressure it has experienced in its 74-year lifetime, including as we emerge and recover from the pandemic. We looked at a wide variety of areas in this Alternative Pathways to Primary Care report. And I want to thank all the witnesses and the clerks and my colleagues for their input. We heard about community link workers. We heard about ALICE, that's the online local digital system for signposting and supporting people. We heard about the role of digital health and care, single electronic patient records, third sector involvement, and lots more. But today I'm going to focus on social prescribing and recruitment. Presiding Officer, in the last session of Parliament, social prescribing were words that weren't as widely used, but now we're seeing more and more people understand what social prescribing is and what it means and what the benefits are. And in our report, the committee welcomed the increased uptake of social prescribing that we witnessed during the course of the pandemic and the positive lived experience we heard from those who have used it. The evidence we heard shows that social prescribing is effective at targeting the causes of health inequalities and can vastly improve mental health and well-being. Others have highlighted this as well, as we've heard this afternoon. However, the committee took evidence that during COVID recovery, patients who use social prescribing are reverting back to contacting their GP in the first instance when ongoing use of social prescribing could offer better outcomes. We heard how cost is a critical barrier to access to social prescribing pathways for people, particularly in areas of multiple deprivation. One of the areas that came up is that there's no single national lead on social prescribing, and given that that responsibility is shared between different government or ministerial portfolios. So I asked the Cabinet Secretary to provide an update on the Scottish Government's work to simplify a national approach to social prescribing and to better align ministerial portfolios so that there is leadership and accountability on social prescribing within alternative pathways to primary care. Presiding Officer, turning to recruitment, the committee heard evidence to suggest that sustainable long-term workforce planning will be a critical prerequisite for encouraging greater use of alternative pathways to primary care in the future. And evidence submitted suggests that this must include consideration of how roles and skills requirements are likely to change as a result of advances in technology and the ongoing evolution of services and their delivery. I agree with Alison Kerr from the Allied Health Professionals Federation Scotland and others when they indicated that it is really important not to look at workforce planning around team members, but to understand it from the point of view of population health need. We must plan the workforce from the point of view rather than saying we need X number of physiotherapists, occupational therapists or dietitians, etc. So I welcome that the Health Secretary launched a new GP recruitment campaign this June as part of the Scottish Government's commitment to increase the number of GPs in Scotland by 2027. The campaign seeks to encourage GPs from the rest of the UK to relocate to Scotland, highlighting the flexible, supportive, collaborative environment available here. This is in addition to the ScotGEM, the Scottish Graduate Entry to Medicine programme, which is allowing those with healthcare and science degrees to train to be GPs, particularly with a focus on rural medicine. Dumfries and Galloway is part of the ScotGEM programme, and feedback from the D&G ScotGEM lead is extremely positive. Scotland is struggling to recruit in social care and nursing. Recruitment is a challenge, presiding officer. And due to the fall in the size of the working age population and the end of free movement of people caused by Brexit, that contributes to the recruitment challenges. While the Scottish Government steps are welcome, recruitment and retention of workforce across multidisciplinary teams are crucial to success in promoting greater use of alternative pathways to primary care. And this is particular interest of mine as we move forward with the scrutiny of the National Care Service Bill. Our report recommended that the Scottish Government provide an update of its work to assist health boards to develop an integrated approach to workforce planning and to overcome recruitment challenges. Finally, presiding officer, the report also describes strengthening the understanding of the role of medical receptionists, who are critical in signposting people to get the support that folks need the most. I welcome the Scottish Government's Right Care, Right Place receptionist campaign, which aims to increase understanding of the role of medical receptionists. And I'm sure lots of work has gone into creating this campaign, but my concern is that this campaign maybe isn't reaching the public as effectively as it could. So perhaps resharing, relaunching needs to be done, which is what I will be doing. I will share on my social media, and I will encourage colleagues to do that also. Presiding officer, in closing, there's loads in this report that was published in June 2022, and securing parliamentary time to debate our reports is absolutely crucial and important. So I am going to encourage members across the chamber to read the report and share, because there is a lot worthwhile in this report. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you. We now move to winding up speeches, and I call on Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, presiding officer, and it is a pleasure to close on behalf of Scottish Labour this fascinating committee debate. And can I first and deeply express my appreciation for the work that the committee did on this report. Some of the statistics in here are challenging for everyone across this chamber to read, but I think it's the sign of a mature Parliament that we are prepared to go out and find this information and then to address it. So my huge compliments to the committee, to their supporting staff, committee members both present and in the past with regard to this. And I echo what my colleague Carol Mockin has said, that Scottish Labour supports the findings of this Health and Social Care and Sport Committee report. Before dealing with some of the contributions which have I think been interesting for a committee debate, and I will address that, there's two aspects from the report that I would like to pick up simply because of my own interest. And I may look to the Cabinet Secretary, given that this was a Scottish Government-funded research, for comments on it. The first is in relation to children under 18 and whether any attempt was made to capture their experiences of primary care. because I think their journey into adulthood is one that is often shaped, sadly, by too many journeys to the GP surgery, too many journeys to the dentist, and in my young children's cases, far too frequent visits to accident and emergency. But I also look at the report... please do.
Gillian Martin.
I just want to commend to Martin Whitfield the other report that we did on children and young people and access to healthcare from them, which has a lot more detail.
Martin Whitfield.
I accept that invitation wholeheartedly. But the other aspect from the statistics that are disclosed in here, and particularly in a very nerdy way, I'm going to talk about figure 15 on page 25 of the report, that the experience of 18 to 29-year-olds is different to almost any other demographic group in respect of this. And it is a level of concern, because to the question, thinking about your work, family and other commitments, how difficult or easy is it being available for appointments during opening hours? And this group between 18 and 29 were the only group for whom it was far more difficult than any of the other groups to attend appointments during opening hours. And in a roundabout way, this has been referred to in a number of the contributions that I would like to turn to. And I think there have been some very powerful contributions from Sandel Gulhani, who is always able to give a real lived experience of what the day of a GP is. And it certainly echoes the many GPs that I have spoken to about the challenges that are there. Of course, I rightly echo Carol Mockin's very powerful speech on it. But I will pause at Willie Rennie's speech. I hope he pauses. His concern is not in anticipation of any detriment that I would say to it, because I think it is important that we look at the background on which this report sits. And I think it does the report an injustice not to recognise the challenges that exist in our health service. And I think to echo the latter part of Willie Rennie, there is without doubt the opportunity of a pathway to a better future. But that's going to be a very hard pathway to follow. And I would urge the government to recognise the challenge, which I hear so often in this chamber, but also to do that so that those who are working across the whole of the National Health Service, working across the whole of primary care, working across the whole of our communities, that they see the support that is so often promised from that point. I need to apologise to Paul McLennan in that I had to step out for an alternative primary pathway reason from my family, but I will take the opportunity to read back. But I think it was interesting, I caught at the end his discussion about the promotion of community prescribing to our GPs in training. And I wouldn't underestimate the challenge in trying to alternate undergraduate courses, having tried to do it with regard to teaching. But I do think it is an important element of how we train a better group of professionals coming forward in their recognition of this very, very valuable service. I have to pause at Sarah Boyack simply because I think to bring into the discussion of the importance of culture is a hugely important one. Culture has always taken the role of protecting our community's mental health. From art that you hate, art that you love, music that is too loud for your parents, music that is the best that you've ever heard, dance that annoys the boys, poetry that sometimes annoys the girls, particularly if it runs in February in a Valentine's card. But the role of culture in supporting the human being to be a human being cannot be underestimated. And the value of that in respect of prescribing out with the tradition of drugs or indeed treatment is so crucially important. And I think it would be a great missed opportunity, particularly at this time. I would like to pause at Stephanie Callaghan's contribution, which I found incredibly powerful. And it actually captured one of the biggest discussion points that we've heard today, the challenge of taking this information out to our communities and the need to do that. The fact that we have plenty of good examples. COVID has taught us the simple pleasure of walking outside, walking by the sea, but the understanding that people have of what a GP does, what primary care is crucially important if we are going to make this work. And I think her call to review how that is announced, how that is put out to our communities is of crucial importance. In the few seconds that I have left, I would just like to make mention of GPs who, in fact, have just contacted me today, this morning on this, to say that there is a discussion that has to be had about the GP contract. There is disappointment the GPs feel about, as is phrased in the letter to me, the reneging by the Scottish Government in respect towards that with the cut in fundings that have been announced. And I know that there is a massive pressure on government budgets because of inflation. But that same inflation is hitting every GP's surgery. It's hitting every pharmacist that can't close. It is hitting our dental surgeries. It is hitting our ophthalmology departments. It is hitting our communities across Scotland. And I think the people of Scotland hear the challenge that the Scottish Government have. I hope the Scottish Government hear the challenge that they have about how to make this better and move forward. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to close debate, today's debate for the Scottish Conservatives. We do all agree on the importance of the work of this committee. The undeniable reality is that our NHS is severely overstretched, and that is especially the case for primary care. Despite the best efforts of GPs and frontline staff in surgeries across Scotland, primary care is struggling to keep pace with demand and increasing complex patient needs. Stephanie Callaghan quite rightly talked about the value of the personal stories to the committee. Evelyn Tweed has said, no doubt, primary care is under pressure. That is, Presiding Officer, a massive understatement. The Deputy Chair of the British Medical Association's Scottish GP Committee put it bluntly, as she rightly should. This is a particularly terrible time for general practice. But there's a wider issue here, which is that the whole system is overwhelmed, from GP practices to A&E. With record waiting times after month, things are getting worse, not better. The NHS is on its knees. As our convener to the committee, Gillian Martin, has highlighted, and I quoted workforce and capacity issues, poor signposting, digital exclusion, limited public awareness, and people feel fobbed off. There simply isn't the capacity in place, yet public messaging from Humza Yousaf and the health boards, such as NHS Grampian in my region, is directing patients away from emergency departments to non-critical care. As the Royal College of General Practitioners says, this approach means that pressure is not relieved, it's only reallocated. The question is how to navigate through this crisis so that patients receive the timely, targeted and high-quality care they need, and primary healthcare professionals do not experience burnout. It's here that the Health, Social Care and Sports Committee's work on alternative pathways to primary care makes an important contribution. As we've heard during today's debate, the Scottish Conservatives believe that alternative pathways to primary care provide a vital way to alleviate the burden on overstretched GPs and other healthcare professionals. My colleague Craig Hoy warned again of the rise in unexplained pharmacy closures due to the Scottish Pharmacy Contract, a key alternative pathway to primary care. I've got a lot to go through, if I may. In the first 5 months of this year alone, staff shortages caused pharmacies to close in almost 1,800 times. Sue Webber raised the relevant and revealing inputs to the committee, the appalling case of her constituent struggling to get an appointment with a cardiologist to diagnose a heart condition. He had to seek private treatment at significant cost. As Minister Marie Todd calls the front door to the NHS, the Scottish Government feels it has communicated well with the public around seeing physios, pharmacists, optometrists, or even podiatrists. But as Sandesh Gulhani says, the public largely do not know. What a huge concern. As Dr. Gulhani tells us, 42% of junior doctors lack access to food, and that obviously leads to burnout. The renegotiated GP contract in 2018 changed the delivery of primary care so that GPs would provide fewer services directly and multidisciplinary team working would be enhanced. But the committee's report highlighted concerns that public awareness of these changes is limited. That has certainly been my experience talking to constituents in the region I represent. It's heartbreaking. And Willie Rennie, in his passionate words, he said, at some point, we must pray that this government will take some responsibility. Gillian Martin outlined the need for advertising. I agree with that. Patients are bewildered by signposting to alternative health practitioners when they have simply requested to speak to their GP. They don't understand why their winter vaccinations are being delivered an hour away and their bus hasn't come again, when they usually just nip down the road to their local surgery. They're getting frustrated with practice receptionists who are often the faces of systemic change that has been poorly managed and poorly communicated to the public by this SNP government. The most recent health and care experience survey should be a wake-up call to the Scottish Government. Only 67% of patients said they were positive about the overall level of care provided by their GP, down by 12% on the previous year, and the lowest level since the survey began. Primary care does need to be reformed, but that process needs to be clearly articulated to the public. It needs to be patient-centred, not just system-focused. As my colleague Carol Mockham points out, the Scottish Government has failed to communicate its vision. The narrative of this SNP government, she says, is simply not true. Services are overwhelmed. We know, of course, and as the British Medical Association has warned, that Scotland is in the middle of a primary care workforce crisis. Minister, your front door to the NHS is off its hinges, and there is a gale blowing. The BMA is clear. Without additional healthcare professionals across a range of areas, it will be near impossible for primary care to offer the range of services communities need or expect. This is a crisis of the SNP's making over many years. The Health Secretary simply isn't doing enough to provide the resources alternative pathways to primary care desperately need to ease the pressure on GPs. As winter approaches, this crisis cannot become a catastrophe under this SNP government. Thank you to Martin Whitfield, who highlighted the importance of people, people in the NHS who are watching us today and the people who are receiving life-saving services. Patient safety and the well-being of staff is at stake, and so are people's lives. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Humza Yousaf.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's been generally quite a good debate with lots of important themes highlighted. Can I thank, of course, the committee, all the members who are on the committee for an excellent report. Can I thank all of those who gave evidence, and can I thank, of course, the committee clerks, who we know do the real hard work. No, I'm just kidding. Of course, our members do fantastic work, but we know the clerks are instrumental in producing such an excellent and high-quality report. Can I reflect on some of the common themes that were mentioned by members right across the chamber? First of all, I think almost every member spoke about the really challenging context and primary care. Dr. Gohani gave his own personal example in terms of a day in the life of a GP. It won't surprise him, I've met many a GP in this role who described similar workload challenges. In fact, I was meeting with Dr. Andrew Buist of the BMA of the Scottish General Practice Council last week, and he described again those really challenging pressures. So you're not going to have any denial from me as the Health Secretary of the scale of that challenge, because I meet with general practice and indeed others in primary care on a very regular basis. And what I would say in particular to, I know Willie Rennie was attempting to set some context, and others too, that not just primary care, but the entire health and social care system has really been hit in the last couple of years or few years by huge shock waves. I would say at least a triple whammy, in fact, I think of probably even more than three shock waves, but Brexit has undoubtedly caused huge impacts. I know Willie Rennie would recognise that, again, particularly in social care, and he was right, as were a number of other members. Gillian Martin, the convener, referenced social care, as did a number of others too, that social care has been hit particularly hard because of the impact and effect of Brexit. Talk to any care home provider or those who represent the care home sector, such as I, Donald McCaskill, who I spoke to yesterday, and they will tell you the enormity of the impact that Brexit has had. But then obviously had the pandemic, and there's no way I could do justice to the scale of the impact that the pandemic has had. And I completely accept from every member here that there was challenges pre-pandemic. I'm not suggesting there wasn't, but there's a world of difference between perhaps pre-pandemic, where we were not quite meeting the 95% target, for example, for A&E, where we were a few percent off or 5% off, compared to where we are now, where performance is not where, of course, I would like it to be in the 60th percentile in England in the 50s. That is a world away from where we were pre-pandemic. So the scale of the challenge has been clearly impacted by the pandemic. Of course, I'll give way to Willie.
Willie Rennie.
That's slightly at odds to what Paul Gray said, the former chief executive of NHS Scotland, who said that this day was coming, it's just COVID brought it forward. It's been building for years. Does he not accept that?
Cabinet
Secretary. I don't think it is at odds, because what I'm accepting is there was clearly challenges, and there's a debate and a discussion to be had how we reform our services moving forward, while of course preserving that central ethos, which I believe and I suspect Willie Rennie undoubtedly believes in, ensuring that our NHS is free at the point of use. But it's difficult to just really, and I don't think we know the full impact, I have to say, of the pandemic yet. We know certain impacts, a certain scale of that impact. But this goes back to the point that, again, was made by a number of members across the chamber, which is that we are seeing patients presenting, whether it's in primary care, which is rightly the focus of this report, or whether it's in secondary care with higher acuity, they are sicker. And therefore, they are needing more complex interventions than perhaps they needed before. And the third kind of shockwave, as it was, that's hit our primary care services and indeed our whole health and social care system is the cost crisis that has come about because of the UK government's complete mismanagement of public finances and the economy. That high inflation, which is impacting public finances and budgets, that cost crisis, which actually is a public health crisis, I would suggest, and we are seeing that triple whammy hitting primary care. So when colleagues speak about budget challenges, whether it's Sandish Gohani, whether it's Carol Mockin, others, they are, of course, right to challenge us on budgets. I think that's absolutely the job of opposition to do so. But I want them to know that as Health Secretary, as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, I do not take these decisions lightly, but they are necessary, given, again, that our budget is now worth £650 million less than when it was set in December. And if we want to pay NHS workers fairly, as I do, putting a record pay deal, higher than the pay deal being offered in England, higher than the pay deal being offered in Wales, then we have to be able to afford that. And I heard Dr. Gohani this morning on the radio, and he was challenged about trying to find where that money would come from. He was unable to do so. Started talking about the fact that we had apparently privatised rail, which is not what we've done. In fact, we brought it into public ownership. But when I challenged Carol Mockin her contribution, what she said, I agree with a bit of vision. But I'm sorry, she wasn't able to identify a single penny that she would put towards that £650 million inflationary cost, or indeed towards a pay deal. I agreed with members around the focus on the whole system, and I can give an absolute guarantee that when it comes to trying to alleviate the pressures on primary care and those alternatives, I hear what they're saying about the communication. I think that's a very fair point made by the committee in its report. I thought it was well made by Emma Harper, it was well made by the convener of the committee and many other members right across the chamber, that we can do more around the communication. I thought Gillian Mackay was absolutely right that we should go to where people are. We should make sure that we are on the platforms, we are ensuring that we are on the places that they frequent. And you know, she mentioned the issue around streaming services, for example. So that is something that we are considering, what more we can do, because I don't think there's a disagreement that those pathways are necessary and effective. What I would say on some of the other issues that were raised, and many a member raising the issue of social prescribing, I just want to give an absolute assurance that we are looking at the recommendations of the report. This national lead to social prescribing is something that I and Minnie Todd and I have asked officials to consider. There is that wide portfolio interest in social prescribing, understandably so, but I'm not opposed in principle to the idea of potentially examining exploring a national lead. In terms of a single electronic patient record, again, a theme that came up very regularly from colleagues right across the chamber, again, I would refer them to our Scottish Health and Care strategy. What we intend to do, as the convener actually highlighted in her contribution very, very well, is to ensure that we have medical records stored, linked and shared securely according to the information that's needed. In terms of how we will do that, we intend to publish a delivery plan in the coming weeks, and I will make sure that is shared to members who had an interest. There are many other areas that were raised, forgive me, Presiding Officer, that I haven't been able to cover them all. I want to once again commend what was a fantastic report by the committee and thank members for all their contributions.
Thank you, and I call Paul O'Kane to wind up the debate on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to 5 o'clock, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to have the opportunity to close this important debate on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, and in common with colleagues across the Chamber, put on record my thanks to the committee clerks, the support staff and all committee colleagues indeed for their work and contributions to the inquiry and the report. As we've heard this afternoon, the inquiry has highlighted several challenges to the implementation of primary care reform and to improving access to and uptake of alternative pathways to primary care. And I think we've had a good debate this afternoon, and I want to thank all colleagues for their contributions and to many of the contributions which highlighted issues in their own local communities across Scotland and where alternative pathways are proving very successful and, of course, where some are still struggling to take hold. I think it was important to hear that breadth and depth of what is happening across the country. From our public survey as part of the inquiry, we heard that there were high levels of uncertainty from respondents about the availability of health practitioners locally, and very few respondents had self-referred directly to most non-GP health practitioners. And again, I think we heard some of that reflected in the debate today. Comments from the members who've spoken have shown that there are ongoing issues with the uptake of alternative pathways to primary care. And I think many members in their contribution, particularly the opening speeches, sought to give perhaps something of the wider context. Sandish Gohani, Carol Mockin, Willie Rennie sought to set out that context, because I think, as Martin Whitfield said in concluding, we can't get away from that, and that is an important debate to have. But we must ensure that we look at all aspects of what is going on in this space and ensure that we engage in a constructive manner. To the government's contributions, both from Marie Todd and indeed in closing from the Cabinet Secretary, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's written response to the inquiry and indeed his contribution today, in which he has outlined, along with Marie Todd, I think, the Scottish Government's ambitions and where it intends the progress it is making and the progress it intends to make in the future. And I know that the committee will continue to take a very keen interest in that dialogue and holding the government to account on that place, because we have to ensure that parents can access, patients can access the right healthcare professional at the right place and the right time. And I think that front door approach. Certainly, I'll take an intervention from the convener.
Julian Martin.
Now, I'm leading in very nicely to what you've just said in terms of, because I think sometimes in the debate we talked about diverting people away from GPs and that being the primary reason for alternative pathways, but it's actually about getting people the right care at the right time with specialists that have the right equipment.
Paul O'Kane.
Of course, I mean, I think that is important to acknowledge, and I think it's difficult sometimes in the context, because of the pressures that we know are on GPs, to perhaps take a step back from that and understand that actually this is about holistic services and the people getting that support. And I think we've heard from Marie Todd and from others about that door approach and that no wrong door approach, and I think we have to ensure that that's at the heart of everything we're doing and that it's not simply about diverting from one place or another. Because there are many non-GP primary healthcare practitioners in Scotland who are available to give patients the help they need. But as has been highlighted during the debate, I think there is still much to do to ensure that we reach that outcome. And I recognise Martin Whitfield's contribution on children and young people, and I would certainly endorse the convener's intervention to him to look at that report, and I know he will. But during the committee's inquiry into the health and wellbeing of children and young people, we heard from young people who encountered real challenges with trying to access support at a time when they were experiencing a crisis, particularly with their mental health, problems, I think, with being believed or taken seriously very often. And I think the ability to self-refer to a mental health professional would provide a real lifeline for people in that situation, enabling them to get quicker and easier access, to get the help they need when they need it, and not always to feel overly medicalised in that space as well. Mental health services were highlighted to the committee as being particularly difficult for patients to refer themselves to, and self-referral not being an option in most health board areas. However, Dr Jess Sussman of the Royal College of Psychiatrists told us it is possible in Glasgow, where 46% of referrals to primary care mental health teams are self-referrals. These mental health teams can then assess whether the patient has a mild to moderate mental health problem or something more serious, in which case they would then be referred to secondary care. The committee believes self-referral to mental health services is an important step, and that all health boards should be making that available. And again, I hope that the Minister, I see the Minister for Mental Health and Wellbeing in this place as well, and I'm sure he will be keen to engage with boards in that respect as well. Although I think we have to be fair that it's not without its challenges, but Glasgow has shown what can be achieved when it is done successfully. The Cabinet Secretary told the inquiry that promoting self-referral to appropriate support will be one element of the new multidisciplinary mental health and wellbeing services in primary care, which is due to be implemented this year, and the committee does welcome that commitment also and looks forward to that becoming a reality very soon. Many members have spoken during the debate about the benefits of social prescribing, and I thought some excellent contributions in that regard. I would particularly highlight Sarah Boyack's very passionate advocacy for therapeutic intervention in culture, and I think we can all recognise something in that and the importance of making that more mainstreamed and better supported. And I do support all the comments we've heard on social prescribing. Many of our witnesses that we saw in committee, I think, identified significant potential for wider social prescribing, particularly for people presenting with problems that are rooted in non-medical issues. However, again, the committee heard that a key barrier to the greater use of social prescribing is the reliability of information on services that are available locally. And actually, I think that's a broad theme that we've heard across the chamber today about getting it right in terms of how we communicate with people, how we tell people what's available, and how we ensure that they can have access. Indeed, Citizens Advice Scotland told the committee social prescribing is beneficial for a certain group, the, quote, savvy group, which is the group that's aware that self-care works and that social activities can help and alleviate issues, but it does not seem to work for other groups, and that can be down to a lack of public awareness. If people knew what was available to them, then it might increase the uptake. Because the issue, I think, of poor signposting was raised many times during the inquiry, and I think we've heard it raised again in the debate today, and certainly Stephanie Callaghan and Gillian Mackay, my colleagues in the committee, made strong contributions, I think, in that regard. We need to have reliable, comprehensive and up-to-date information about local and national services, and I think that would greatly assist signposting of patients and encourage greater use of alternative pathways. I think we've had some contributions on ALICE today, and I know that my colleague Emma Harper is in committee, always a strong advocate for the use of ALICE. That's the Local Information System for Scotland database, which is run by Health and Social Care, and trying to interrogate, I think, the ways that ALICE could work better, or local versions of a library could work better as well. ALICE is obviously run by the Health and Social Care Alliance and funded by government. So whilst the committee recognises the value of such a database and sees the potential for ALICE to help improve signposting, there are concerns about the constantly changing landscape of providers and non-GP primary care services limiting perhaps the reliability of information that's available, and that need for that kind of constant monitoring and updating. Because by significantly improving general awareness of it among health practitioners and the accuracy, reliability and comprehensiveness of information it contains, the committee believes that ALICE has the potential to become an authoritative source of data for those seeking to signpost patients towards alternative pathways to primary care. Our report calls on the Scottish Government to work in partnership with the Alliance to undertake an assessment of the actions and associated funding required to achieve this. And I am pleased to note from the Cabinet Secretary's written submission to the Scottish Government that he has since met with ALICE, the Alliance, to progress that work. And we look forward to further information on that. In drawing my remarks to a close, Presiding Officer, I want to again thank everyone who contributed to the debate this afternoon, echoing the convener's words of gratitude for the contributions that we received during the inquiry. As we've heard today, despite a debate that was at times sparky, I think it's fair to say, I think we have managed to all agree that the principle of primary care reform and that people getting care in the right time and the right place is something that we all share in the this chamber. However, it's clear that for that to happen, there are a number of important challenges to overcome. The public must have greater confidence that in many instances their GP might not be the first port of call, and that using an alternative pathway might give them quicker and easier access to the treatment they need. The option of self-referral needs to be more widely available and accessible and better understood. Information needs to be up to date and available to all, both online and offline, because we cannot forget about a whole section of society who do not have access to the internet and who still find it challenging to access information in that space. And I think by addressing these challenges, alternative pathways have the potential to really transform how patients experience primary care, shifting the focus towards a more preventative approach with quicker and better outcomes for everyone. And I think very clearly today is not a full stop, but a comma in our debate and our discussion on these issues. And we look forward to continuing to progress the recommendations in this report. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 6711 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 6702, in the name of Gillian Martin, on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, on inquiry into alternative pathways to primary care, be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed. The final question is that motion 6711, in the name of George Adam, on approval of an SSI, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.